Hello everyone, this is Pal Ponder on Weather. In this video, we're going to be talking about a multi-day severe weather outbreak, and then it gets cold again out west along with some snow, and then next week, the severe weather really starts to ramp up. So if you're new to the channel, click the subscribe button and the notification bell to get all my daily updates to keep you ahead of the storm. So let's get right to it. Here is your record low temperatures for this morning, Thursday, April the 22nd. And this has been a very cold shot of Arctic air that sunk all the way down to the deep south, breaking numerous records. And this morning, that just extended all the way down to Louisiana, the Florida Panhandle. All these areas in teal are near record lows. All the areas in blue actually broke a daily record. And some of these go back almost 100 years. So this has been a very impressive cold shot. The temperatures do rebound for tomorrow and forecasted only about 7 record lows as the winds start to turn around. And you can actually see that in the water vapor imagery. So as we go later on today, we've got all this dry air that's sneaking in out west, but the winds turn around. I mean, it's got to pull in all this Gulf moisture. And as the winds turn, it flips from a northwest flow to a southwest flow out here in Texas. So it increases the mid-latitudes and it increases all layers of the atmosphere. And eventually over time, the dew points will start to moisten up. And that will set the stage for our severe weather outbreak that looks to take place starting tomorrow afternoon, Friday afternoon, and really start to kind of ramp up as it goes into East Texas, goes into the Ark-La-Tex, goes into the Southeast as it really trails fast. I mean, these things are going to be moving 40, 50 miles an hour, and these will eventually swing off the coast. And then next week, we rebound, but then next week, we really have to watch out this dry line as we get into Tuesday and Wednesday. We're talking the 27th and the 28th timeframe. And unfortunately, that is the 10-year anniversary of that super tornado outbreak that happened back in 2011. And so you know what happened with that particular event. And this event looks serious, guys, as this dry line really starts to get cranking by the time we go into Tuesday evening and Wednesday. And we could be setting the stage for yet another multi-day severe weather outbreak. And this could be one of the biggest ones we've seen all season. So I'm definitely concerned even with that event. But we have a lot to deal with before we get to that. As here's the latest surface map. As we go into later this afternoon, we had all that snow that went across the board over the last 3 days. That snow is continuing to lift off into the northeast. We kind of reset, down here below, you can see the orange here where the winds are going to start turning around. So these overnight lows were a good 15 to 20 degrees warmer in, say, Dallas than they were just yesterday when they had that record low, as the winds starting to really start to turn around from the southwest, pulling in some of that Gulf moisture. And you can see it really ramping up by in the latest NAM model as far as the dew points. As we go into Friday afternoon, this sets the stage. We've got some very dry air behind it. This would be your dry line. It's basically a sector, a separation from your drier air to your warm, moist air. So you have the warm sector out ahead of it. When you see dew points, getting into the low 70s, if not the upper 60s, for late April, that is a recipe for supercell thunderstorms, especially as we get this active dry line starts to get cranking by the time we go into Friday afternoon. So in fact, the latest outlook from the Storm Prediction Center has that dry line very active. So I depicted all three modes. Here's your hail threat, and we actually have a hatched hail threat. So this is more of an enhanced hail threat for the atmosphere to be conducive for large hail, meaning these would be greater than 1 inch, possibly golf ball size hail, potentially in this hatched area. So I'm deeply concerned areas like, say, in the Dallas-Worth area, Austin, Fort Worth, getting into Oklahoma City, getting into Arlington, everywhere here in this dotted shaded area, could be susceptible from those isolated supercells that could produce golf ball size hail or potentially greater in isolated areas. And this whole area down in Houston, San Antonio, getting into Fort Worth, is all the way down to Austin, is going to be under that slight risk. So there's going to be two modes. It seems like there's going to be an area down here to the southeast that I would not be surprised that would be upgraded to an enhanced risk, you know, later on this afternoon, where I feel like the dry line is going to get active and kind of separate and turn more tornadic potentially as we go out here in southeast Texas, going into east Texas, into Louisiana. And you can definitely see that depicted in the Storm Prediction Center highlighted threat for the tornado threat. And I do feel this particular threat would actually go up and updated areas. And then we have a secondary threat that could be forming off the cold front coming in from Oklahoma down, you know, later on, you know, in the afternoon, getting into the overnight. So let's kind of walk you through the latest NAM model. I do feel this, the NAM 3K, by 3 o'clock, by 2-3 o'clock, I do feel storms are going to start to fire off the dry line, start off in the southwest Texas here, going in just west of the Dallas-Fort Worth area. Well, it should be setting up around Fort Worth and then traversing eastward as we go through late afternoon. And like I said, it's going to start off as a large hail threat, probably west of the I-35 corridor, and then shift east, you know, throughout the late afternoon, and then transition into more of a tornado threat down here into the southeast as we go into, you know, 5 o'clock in the afternoon. Here's the latest simulated radar by at 5 o'clock in the afternoon on Friday, where we see supercell thunderstorms down here in the southwest. This would be your Dallas-Fort Worth area, right along that boundary there. And I do feel once it gets probably east of the I-35 corridor, it transitions more of into a, you know, has a large hail threat too, but it transitions to more of a, you know, rotation in the atmosphere southeast of Dallas here, more of a tornado threat where the atmosphere could be spinning up. And down here, up here in Oklahoma, we have to be on the lookout for these storms starting to develop, could be forming and traversing into a linear band. Some stronger thunderstorms and out ahead of it, we still have thunderstorms in Missouri, getting into Arkansas, and these will extend into east Texas, going into Louisiana. As we go into, this is 9 o'clock. So as 9 o'clock, like I mentioned, there's going to be two modes. So I do feel like this first round is going to be past the Dallas-Fort Worth area and be extended off into east Texas. This would be more of a tornado threat, wind threat, and then a little bit lesser hail threat. You could still be getting larger hail, but maybe not as prominent as what you saw earlier. And up here to the north here, that's where we could be having some very large hail with this particular second setup, diving down here from Oklahoma, getting across the Red River. This would be 9 o'clock, and these could be having some very strong winds to it as it forms into a linear band as we go into the overnight hours. Here's 1 o'clock in the morning, and this linear band traverses around Oklahoma, getting into northwest Arkansas, and then out ahead of it, yeah, this is that two-mode sector. So there's going to be a mode down here in the southeast and another mode up here northwest of it, and this will come through as some strong gusty winds, probably some large hail to it, and we'll see how far this is able to back build back into the Dallas-Fort Worth area as it goes through into the overnight hours. This would be your 1 o'clock in the morning time frame by then. And as we expand the view and should kind of show you the big picture on the national front, you can definitely see those two-prong approach where you have that first band forms into a linear band going into Mississippi and Alabama with that severe weather threat. It kind of lessens as you go further north because we still have a lot of that cold air draining in from the north into Tennessee, getting into Kentucky, getting into Illinois, into Indiana. And then where that warm sector is further south, that's more of your severe weather threat going into Saturday. And in fact, the Storm Prediction Center, you can see, I mean, this is the area that's concerned for Friday, and this is a quick mover. So by the time we go into Saturday, it's already passed and getting into New Orleans, going into Mobile, going into Atlanta area. you know, into South Carolina, where that severe weather threat would be prevalent in those areas up down in the southeast. And you would have potentially all three storm modes available there as the dew points will start to get really cranking. The Cape values are still high down here, about 2,000 joules. And then we'll have ample precipitation. And it has more of a heavier rain threat as we go, you know, further northward, where they're tapping into that, cooler, those cooler temperatures. But you can see the temperatures, but as we go into Saturday, as it really starts to rebound, I mean, even 77 in Dallas, I mean, this has been a very strong cold air mass, and it's been an extended cold air mass and a below normal air mass. In fact, this would be your ninth going in almost 10th day in a row of below average temperatures. The average temperature, say 78 in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. The last time they had 10, below average temperatures in a row back in April of 2009, back in that same April timeframe. So for April, this has been a very cold, time frame over the last 10 days, below average temperatures for much of the central U.S. But that will quickly come to an end as the winds start to turn around. And you can definitely see the 80 degree high temperatures are starting to creep back in from the south, and these will only extend further northward as we go through time. But there's more cold air. This will start to funnel in off the Pacific Northwest, and those colder temperatures will, so it'll be a flip. I mean, we had very warm temperatures out west and colder temperatures central and east. Now it's going to be completely the opposite of colder temperatures starting to creep back in out west, and then warmer temperatures surging back up into the central and eventually getting into the east as we go over time. This would be by Sunday, as this low will continue traversing up the coast. I do feel these won't probably be severe by then because you got a lot of cold air still around to the north, but these will be some stronger storms, you know, extending into the mid-Atlantic states, going up into the northeast. But you can definitely see out west, that's where your cold air is going to be, and the snow is going to be flying into the higher elevations, bringing the precipitation back into off the west coast into Washington and Oregon by then. And this will tail traversing down, and then we'll get rain moving back into the picture, getting all far south as Los Angeles by then as we go into Sunday, and it'll start to really pick up again on Monday. But you can see definitely the anomalies by the time we go into Sunday afternoon, as this cold air begins to fade. We have that warm, moist air, you know, out ahead of it, and cold air behind it out west, with these well below average anomalies of the 10 to 15 degrees below average anomalies coming back into California, going into Nevada. And that's going to be setting the stage for our second severe weather outbreak, and that will be going into Tuesday and Wednesday. Here's the surface map by Monday, the 26th. That low will be, you know, going off the coast again, as we're looking at more rain, like I mentioned, for LA coming back into the picture, as that snow starts to really creep a little bit further south now, off into the Pacific Northwest. Here's your anomalies by Monday afternoon. There's your cold air behind it. There's your warm surge out ahead of it. And where that temperature gradient, that's going to set the stage for probably another severe weather outbreak. And this one looks probably going to be the most numerous and expansive coverage of event we've seen all season. So this is the one I'm really concerned about, especially as we go into Tuesday and Wednesday. As you can see, the temperatures really start to crank up by Monday, the 26th. There is your high temperature. So you can see the continued warm surge. I mean, we're talking almost 80 degrees all the way up into Iowa, going into Chicago by then, as 80s and 90s. And then you'll have your 50s down here in the Pacific Northwest, where you'll have those colder anomalies creeping in. And in fact, I mean, even yesterday, they had the slight risk of severe weather, and that just expanded off the dry line. So, I mean, the event, the super outbreak that happened back in 2011, they had a day five slight risk, and that ended up being a high risk area. And we all know what happened back in April 27, 2011 with that super outbreak. So I'm getting very concerned. I mean, this could be a large scale event as it really kind of explodes. And I show you just the water vapor imagery. By the time we go into Tuesday night into Wednesday, it really starts to explode off that dry line. And that's where the Storm Prediction Center already expanded this slight risk, even this far out, deep down into Texas, into Oklahoma, covering three states already. And I do feel this will probably expand even further as we go into time. Going into Tuesday, there's your high temperatures. So you can see we have a lot of warm air out ahead of it, colder air back behind it, warm out ahead of it. You got ample amount of moisture. That clash in temperatures is not going to be a pretty setup for the central U.S. as these. This is the latest 700 millibar of vorticity index. As we go into Tuesday afternoon, you can definitely see a lot of the rotation, the spin in the atmosphere, very warm southwest winds out ahead of it. The dry line gets really start to get cranking over Texas, Oklahoma, getting into Kansas by Tuesday. And I just feel like it just kind of really explodes and forms into a linear band traversing multi-state event. With some very tornadic supercells probably by then, some very large hail and damaging winds. So I'm deeply concerned about this setup that would be coming up even for next week. Going into Tuesday, there's your Wednesday setup, and that will just continue traversing across into the southeast, covering a multi-state event again by then. So man, and then here's your precipitation just for between now and Tuesday. So that has this first setup where it comes off the dry line off Texas. There's your initial band from Dallas-Fort Worth eastward into Oklahoma City, into Kansas, going into Missouri, Arkansas, and then a little bit heavier rain threat down into Louisiana, Mississippi, and Alabama traversing. And then as we go further north, where the colder temperatures will be felt, these storms won't be nearly as strong, the precipitation won't be nearly as heavy, and they'll just have, maybe 1 inch. And then back behind it, yeah, we have much needed moisture back off the Pacific Northwest. And like I mentioned, this will kind of back build over time, setting it a little bit further south into Sunday and to Monday. And there's your snow they're going to be dealing with where those colder temperatures. Most of this is going to be, in the higher elevations up here in the Pacific Northwest. But yeah, more snow for ski country out here in Idaho and Montana. And this will even bring more snow into the mountains of Utah into Colorado as this that first system will be lifting off the coast earlier in the week. If we actually include Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday precipitation for next week as this will continue moving across, you can definitely see where the greatest concern of instability would lie with that severe weather outbreak. We could be having a multi-day event with very heavy rain, and these could be flooding rains down south and tornadic supercells. And so obviously we'll be fine-tuning this as we go deeper into next week, but we've got a lot to be concerned about coming up for tomorrow, and especially as we go into Saturday for much of Texas and swinging off into the southeast. So hey, I appreciate you guys watching. Do like this video, definitely leave your comments below, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel to catch the latest update where I protect you before and after the storm.